This is the Relevant Podcast. It's episode 1038, and it's the Relevant Podcast. Here in Orlando, I'm your host, Cameron Stray, and joining me from Loverland, Virginia, it's Jesse Carey.
Hello, hello.
From Nashville, Tennessee, artist, producer, mogul, Derek Miner.
What up, Don?
And still in Houston for a wedding, our very own downtown Emily Brown.
Hey, y'all.
Jamie's off this week once again. We have a great show in store for you today. Coming up later, Shane Claiborne joins us. It's been a while since we've talked to Shane. He's one of our favorite activists and thought leaders. We also have slices. We have a little game at the end. I think we're just going to do some table topics, some get to know you with the cast, you know, all that kind of stuff. So there you go. It's going to be a good one.
It's always a fun time of year, you know, like coming out of the holidays. They just announced, and I was very anxious about or eager this year to see how this was going to shake out, but they just announced the Oscar nominations, and the ones that interest me are always Best Picture, because I feel like it's been a long time since there's one I even care to watch. Like, I would say since Shape of Water, you know, it's like they're just getting weird, or like you've never heard
Shape of Water.
Like
was pretty weird. I'm sorry.
Even the one last year I heard was a good movie, but it's like the
Coda.
Coda. It's like, When did this even release? Like, what is this film? I know no one in this. I don't even know where, if I wanted to watch it. Like, it just seems like they're so out of touch. I can't tell you how thrilled I am Top Gun Maverick is up for Best Picture. I have a theory. If Top Gun Maverick wins, I think it's really going to, like, it's just going to inject optimism into our society. It's going to be looked at as the turning point. Like, man, remember when we came out of the pandemic and everything was, you know, pretty tough for a while, and everything was a bummer. Then Top Gun Maverick won Best Picture, and the whole world was just like, shirtless football is a good thing, and it should be celebrated, and we just need to love life. Guys, are you... Because the other, I mean, they have like, you know, some indie movies on, like Everything Everywhere All at Once. They have like hardcore war movies, All Quiet on the Western Front. They have like a Spielberg kind of prestige project. Just the fact that Top Gun Maverick, a film with a plot that can be described in one single sentence. You know what I mean?
What is it?
What's that sentence? Disgraced fighter jet pilot pulls off impossible mission. Like, period. That's all you need to know. Like, who's the enemy? They don't even tell you. It doesn't matter. All you're doing is watching Tom Cruise look cool for 2 hours, and you're going to love it. There is no plot. There is no enemy. It just looks awesome. I'm here for it. I was so stoked.
I have not seen it, nor have I seen the first one.
You don't need to see the first one. See the second one, though. It's good.
Okay. It is good.
You'll enjoy
it's
it.
Good?
It is funny that Top Gun Maverick is awesome. Nominated because it does feel just like a random pick for the Oscar, because they normally are these like weird indie super prestige ones, and then it's like Top Gun, just guys being dudes, and I love it.
Guys being dudes.
I think it's so funny. I mean, I had a great time watching it, but what's also funny
how
is,
can you not?
I do think Top Gun Maverick, didn't it also get nominated for like best screenplay? I think it did, which is extra funny considering, like you said, the whole movie
there
can be summed
really
up.
There is no plot.
There is no plot. So
there's, and the movie has one mission. It's not like you follow them through this whole career. It is one mission, and they spend about 2/3 of the movie re-explaining the mission.
And right,
it's just over and over. You see video simulations. You see them in a classroom. You see them test flying it. It is building. It is like, we are going to make the simplest movie in a world where like there's multiverses and Christopher Nolan reversing time and movies get so like you feel like you got to take notes in half the movies you see these days. Like, all right, so which universe did he cross parallel, inject himself into the quantum manium? Okay. I think I'm following. This one is like, no, dude, they have to fly a jet through the mountains and blow up a gun, and we're going to walk you through it 15 times before it happens. So you're very clear on what I... To me, it simplified it so much that I was just like, dude, I am here for this. Derek, I'm kind of shocked you haven't seen
this
it.
This is played in my, just played in my personal hell, I think. Is
what No, it's actually a good movie. He's making it sound terrible. It's actually a lot of fun. You would enjoy it. It's a good popcorn movie.
Do you
movie.
Disagree with my assessment, though? that it is one mission that they spend most of the movie just re-explaining over and over again.
Well, now that you're saying it like that, you're making me like the movie less. You know what I mean? Like, I enjoyed the movie, and now you're making me go, oh, yeah, that was stupid.
That's why I enjoyed it. That's why I enjoyed it, because they zig where the whole world's zagging. The whole world's zagging where you got to watch 15 movies just to catch up.
I'm out, bro.
Like, I feel like I can't go to a movie these days without, like, having to read, like, a primer on the internet about, like, the five preceding movies. Derek, this has no appeal to you.
There's nothing in this movie for me.
You would like it, dude. I'm telling you. I know you. You would enjoy it. You would enjoy it.
This man said that the movie is about the same mission being played 15 times over.
But it's like
one in the classroom, one in the simulator.
Derek, you'll enjoy it. Trust me, you'll enjoy it. It's a good movie. It's fun.
It is good, but that's what I'm saying. It's good because you don't have to think. Like,
is there action in the movie?
Oh, yeah.
They refly the same mission over and over.
Everyone I've talked to that's seen it, they have not regretted watching it.
It's a great mission.
Nobody walked out of seeing it and didn't love it. Everybody who saw it loved it.
Yeah.
That's the truth.
And apparently someone in the Academy really loved it because they wanted it to be a nominee for Best Picture. I do hope it is a turning point, like you said, Jesse, because, again, I love, like, the cool indie movies and stuff, but I also love a good movie where, you know, if I just, like, check out for 5 minutes and hop back in, didn't miss anything. Maybe a shirtless scene, whatever. Like,
listen,
got you.
Exactly.
I don't watch those kinds of movies, Emily. Goodness gracious.
But here's the thing. Scenes. I think the trajectory of pop culture will go one of two ways. If you have either Top Gun or Elvis winning, it's going one way. If you have a movie called The Triangle of Sadness, which I'm certain nobody has seen wins, pop culture's going a different direction here. Like,
that sounds awful.
Exactly. Let's go Top Gun.
But are the Oscars pop culture, though? Are the Oscars pop culture? Because I feel like they haven't been pop culture for a long time.
That's a good point.
How about this, though? The Oscars still can demand the attention of pop culture. Look no further than the Will Smith slap last year. Like, if it wasn't for the relevance of the award ceremony, I don't think that would have been as big a deal. Like, I think the Oscars still can command a huge presence.
I think it was a
culture.
Big deal because Will Smith smacked the taste out Chris Rock's mouth.
And it was Will Smith.
That's what I'm saying. I think Will Smith, it was bigger than the Oscars.
Yeah,
in my opinion.
But
could have happened at Chipotle and it'd have been the same thing.
I don't think it would have been. I think it would have been an interesting story and people would have talked about it, but there's something about them in tuxedos at this, like, kind of formal event that's on primetime TV where pretty much actors are there solely to celebrate the work of someone like Will Smith, who actually won Best Actor that night. Like, to me, his positioning in the movie industry, like you said, he is bigger than the Oscars, but the Oscars, you know, provided the platform for that to be this crazy pop culture moment, you know?
Did they take away his Oscar? Or I know they banned him for 10 years, but
no
he didn't take away. Yeah, he can't. Mm-hmm. He can't come back to the Oscars for 10 years.
Interesting. All right. Well, we have a great show. Let's get going. Stay tuned. Up next, it's Slices.
I'll change my outfit one too many times. Every whisper of every hair is out of I'm borderline and saying anything, say my name, a little bit better, let me change. I've played safe and I've made mistakes, but you make the others.
You're listening to Matilda Mann and Spill Tab. The song is Borderline Insane. Okay, it's time for
Slices.
What do you have, Jesse?
All right, this one, people can go to relevantmagazine.com to learn more about this particular story about the recent findings of a poll from an agency called Morning Consult. Basically, they did a bunch of research on what are the American public's thoughts about various film directors. Now, there were two kind of notable findings. This study is crazy. Emily, I know you spent some time looking at it. It's like 400 pages, literally 400 pages. I was kind of going through this morning. They found that among the 18 to 34 demographic, among major kind of Hollywood directors and filmmakers, who do you guys think had the highest favorability rating among the 18 to 34 demographic?
Young adults. They're cool.
I found this very surprising, but after I started thinking about it, I think I kind of understand why.
So wait, young adults, 20-somethings would have been formed 10, 15 years ago when they were younger. So Pixar would have been big. What was a big movie Marvel, 10 years ago that a 12-year-old would have seen? Marvel stuff. Yeah, probably in that lane.
The director with the highest favorability rating among 18 to 34-year-olds is Tim Burton. Now, I started thinking about why this would be.
I could see that.
And I think it's for a couple of reasons. One, I think, like, obviously, like, The Nightmare Before Christmas, like, Batman, even Wednesday recently was a huge hit among kind of the 18 to, I don't know, 25. I think that's probably right in that show's sweet spot. But I also think he has such a distinct visual style that you automatically know when you see a Tim Burton movie. It's like, oh, this is clearly Tim Burton.
Like Wes Anderson or something.
Yeah, exactly. And I think because so many of his films have that fantastical element that it does tie it to nostalgia, you know, that's just my guess.
See, but I would have thought Wes Anderson would have been in that conversation. Maybe they're a little too young. Maybe it's 25 to 40 or something would have been Wes Anderson.
But the other one that I found is they asked Christians what filmmakers had the highest favorability rating. Any
Kevin
guesses?
Sorbo. Kevin Sorbo. Kirk filmmaker. Cameron. Kirk filmmaker. Cameron.
Oh. Have they directed anything? They probably have. I just haven't seen it.
Any guesses? I'll say this. It's a very prominent name.
It's got to be a family friendly. Derek, who do you think? Christian's number one director. I'm going family friendly.
Jesus.
Got to be like PG movies, G movies.
Steven Spielberg. Let's go.
Ding, ding, ding. It's Spielberg. Spielberg is number one. Now, I found that interesting, but not surprising. But then I started looking through the favorability. Yeah, exactly. He's very safe. They're family-friendly movies that they're well-made. But then I started looking through. I was just curious about the favorability ratings of directors. I'm going to name a director that has a higher favorability rating than Ridley Scott, Darren Aronofsky, both of whom have made biblical movies in Exodus and Noah. Has a higher favorability rating than Ryan Johnson, Christopher Nolan, Wes Anderson, Jon Favreau, Patty Jenkins, Jordan Peele, Steven Soderbergh, even Peter Jackson, who makes Tolkien movies with heavy spiritual themes. Guess what director has a higher favorability rating among Christians? It is a surprise. Quentin Tarantino.
What?
Among Christians has a higher favorability rating than all of those directors I just named.
All right. Yeah, you got me there. I'd never guessed that one.
Just like given the content of his film, like even non-Christians are sometimes like, it's a little much for me. That's interesting.
I'm trying to think, like Pulp Fiction, he hasn't had a non-R-rated movie yet.
Yeah, and but they're all hard R.
Right.
That relish in violence and
Kill Bill.
Yeah.
Yeah.
What Christian is watching Kill Bill and telling a survey about it? That's crazy.
Again, a higher favorability rating than Peter Jackson. Crazy.
Kill Bill is Uma Thurman wielding a sword for two movies and slicing people. And it's like when the blood gushes out of people's body, it's like a fountain.
Ryan Johnson literally was a youth group kid and makes these like very interesting movies about, you know, class and morality. Like I said, two of the filmmakers that he's bigger than, Ridley Scott and Darren Aronofsky, have made biblical movies, literally movies based on the Bible. Soderbergh, like, is one of the most interesting kind of thought-provoking filmmakers, working. Like I said, Peter Jackson has adapted the works of one of Christianity's greatest writers or modern writers in Tolkien, yet Tarantino is still has a higher favorability rating just among Christians.
I have a thought here, and I could be wrong. I could be wrong here, but now that I'm sitting here thinking about all of the people that you brought up, the thing that Quentin Tarantino is different from all those people and Spielberg is with their movies, they get direct to the point. Like, you don't have to guess. There's no guesswork there. Like, Quentin Tarantino, like, Inglourious Basterds is about World War II, Hitler, and all of that. And I think it's the framing of it that may necessarily make it a little bit more digestible if they feel very to the point. Like, all of the movies, Steven Spielberg, Jurassic Park, it's about dinosaurs. Like the Noah movie is a lot of controversy there. Like, you got to kind of figure out what's what. Maybe it's the fact that it just kind of is what it is. You know what I'm saying?
So you're because I think this is interesting. You think that the lack of subtlety and subtext in like a Tarantino movie where it's like Kill Bill is just about vengeance. There's not much more subtext, right? Or, like Django or...
I have another theory.
Yeah.
My theory is completely different than y'all's.
Okay.
My theory is Christians, middle America, heartland Christians, haven't really seen any movies. They don't, it's not a thing for them. They're given a list of director names and they were favoring the ones that they've heard of. Because they don't know Peter Jackson as well as Quentin Tarantino is more famous as a name recognition thing. So Steven Spielberg is the most famous name. Of course they know him. But but I guarantee you these Christians couldn't... You guys are talking about the plots and nuances of Tarantino movies? They haven't seen any of them. They just heard of them. And that guy's creative. He's innovative.
I don't know.
I think that maybe recognition is part of it.
They see Kill Bill.
But like, I think recognition might be part of it. But... like just, I know on the survey, it was kind of, you rate like most super favorable, somewhat favorable, not favorable. Like, so it wasn't just like, do you recognize the name? It was like, do you?
It was favorability. Yeah,
but like, okay, Quentin Tarantino is an award winning, Oscar winning, innovative, and like he's famous, like he's favorable. So they check that box. Like they don't know why or what specifically. I don't think Christians know his art.
See, I disagree. Me, Cameron, we have this conversation offline all the time. Mm-hmm. I think that you have a more optimistic view of people as who they actually are. And I think this is an opportunity. This was an opportunity for people to say, yeah, I like Quentin Tarantino. Like, because it's just a survey. There's no
their pastor won't find out.
Pastor's not going to find out.
Yeah.
There's no social pressure there to say, well, I don't watch Quentin Tarantino. I'm a Christian.
Interesting.
Like, there's no social pressure there. So like, I think it's, I think people watch that stuff, man. Like, you can't tell me these movies are doing the numbers they're doing and Christians aren't participating in America when most of America's Christians.
True.
Like, by title.
I was talking about the K-Love audience. I don't think that soccer mom.
They watch it too.
Okay.
They just make fun of you for watching it because of the social pressure. Because a lot of Christians are hypocrites. Let's just keep it real.
That's actually true. Eric did mention how Tarantino films are like very graphic and violent. We talked a few weeks ago about The Passion of the Christ, which is incredibly graphic and violent. So I don't know if that...
Zero problems with it.
I don't know if that necessarily deters... Okay,
so Christians are okay with violence and gore. Yeah, that's true.
I mean, Tarantino's language is also rough, but...
They're okay with the language. They're okay with the language until the social pressure comes in. It's the social pressure that makes a lot of Christians... act the way they act online and in real life. I'll never forget this one day. I was going to a church. They made me throw away all my secular music.
Same.
Like I didn't throw it away. I was like, y'all are loony. But I literally watched people throwing secular music away and burning it on fire outside of a church building. And then we go to the pastor's house and we were leaving. Somebody's car cuts on and they are bumping Young Jeezy at ungodly levels. They forgot to cut it off before they went in the house. And I'm looking, I'm like, you threw away all your secular music, huh? Like, I'm not a fool. Like, it's the social pressure for a lot of Christians. Like, I'm telling you, bro, like people are not, like Christians are not as wholesome as we like to make it, but they project that because of the social pressure. Because it's a lot of Christianity has weird standards that we all have to live up to. Like, hey, oh my God, you're 40 years old, but you can't watch a movie with blood or cussing in it.
Derek, like, everybody. I don't listen to like explicit lyric music, and it's my choice as an adult.
Because you are the sweetest human being, bro. For real, like no lie, bro. You are a really kind person. You believe the best in a lot, but bro, that's not how this works, bro. Like, bro, most Christians voted for Donald Trump. He said he was gonna grab women by their private parts, bro. Talking about, bro?
Yeah,
this man is one of the most. I'm not even trying to hate, but this man was one of the most immoral people in the world, and Christians voted for him in droves.
That's
so
true.
You're not gonna sit up here and sell me that they're not watching Quentin Tarantino films, bro. I don't care. Go ahead. I'm sorry, Jesse. I've been
off. I think you're right about the social pressure thing, and I think it honestly starts at the top. Like, I'm not calling out any names here, okay? But if you had like a prominent Bible teacher or pastor or worship leader And you had a conversation with them off the record about like, hey, what do you think of Once Upon a Time in Hollywood or Pulp Fiction? Or I guarantee you they've seen them because they're at the end of the day, they're normal people. But then if you brought them on K-Love or you brought them on a podcast and say, hey, we were just talking about how you really liked Once Upon a Time in Hollywood, the scene where they burned up all those Nazis at the end. You want to talk about that? Of course they wouldn't do it publicly because there is social pressure and there is a dissidence between what we expect, you know, a quote unquote Christian to be and what they actually are in real life. Like that dissidence exists. And I think maybe what we're seeing is some reflection of that in the poll survey results.
I'm going to agree with you, but don't lump it all as everybody's like that. Cause I'm just saying for me, when I was in college, I saw Pulp Fiction and I might've seen Reservoir Dogs and I haven't seen a Tarantino movie since then. So I haven't seen Kill Bill. I haven't seen any of those. Cause it's just not my thing. I don't watch horror movies. I don't watch gore. I don't watch profane stuff. Cause I just, you know, garbage in, garbage out. I'm pretty sensitive to that stuff. And so
this is what I'm saying. I'm not saying that every Christian is a raving hypocrite.
Okay.
What I am saying is
I felt like that Christians, was the momentum of this conversation.
I'm just saying it exists within
the, I'm saying that Christians are okay. Christians have a level of cognitive dissonance when it comes to what they consume and what they check others on consumption. And a lot of that often comes with a lot of that also comes with social pressure. Like you may not watch rated R movies, but there's some things that you've seen or watched that you wouldn't come on a podcast and talk about. Like it may be some music, a song, something. Like all of us have things that's like, all of us a guilty pleasure. Like there's people that are like, yo, you know what? I wouldn't tell people that I'm listening to Lil Uzi Vert, but you know, like especially the kids do this all the time. Like if you lumping kids in there, they're like, yeah, we're listening to Lil Uzi Vert. I love Lecrae. But yeah, if my friends are bumping Lil Uzi Vert, right, I'll download that.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
But I wouldn't care to tell everybody that. I mean, that's my thing. It's like, I try, and this is the honest to God truth. I try to live in a way that like, if my secrets were known, I'm fine. Like, it's like, I'm going to, let's put it out there myself. Like, I don't want to hide anything.
And then there's also the other layer of the people that listen to that stuff, but they kind of, it's kind of like, they're sick after they listen to it. They're like, oh man,
they
like,
feel guilty.
You know what? I probably shouldn't have watched that, but it was pretty good. But it's the wrestle between like what you actually enjoy and what you're supposed to enjoy. And what you know you should enjoy.
Right.
Right? They're like, I should be watching God's Not Dead, but you know what? I just want to watch, you know, Once Upon a Time in Hollywood because all my friends are watching it to see what it's about. And then you leave and you're like, it's a good movie, but dang, that was pretty immoral. I probably shouldn't have watched that, right? You know, there's that wrestle there. So I'm not saying everyone's raving hypocrites. I'm just saying like most of the time, the people that would watch a Tarantino movie, they're not going to just outright say, you wouldn't expect that because we don't expect Christians to watch things with violence and immoral things in them. But the reality is a lot of us do.
I got halfway into one episode of Game of Thrones and I was like, I'm a single Christian guy. I shouldn't be watching this. You know what I mean?
Wow.
So I stopped watching it. You know what I mean?
Like, but I think like this shows like, I'm not saying it's prevalent in every Christian as some kind of hypocrite, but I do think that the social pressures of a version of Christianity that is very focused on morality, almost elevated above spirituality. And sometimes like, especially I feel like depending on how you were raised, sometimes, you know, morality was the most, you know, kind of important thing. I think what this, considering that the director who you would be on the short list for least favorable, like if I had to make a list of directors that I think Christians nationally would produce the least favorable content, Quentin Tarantino would probably be on that list.
100%.
Right? The fact that he has a higher ranking than people who have literally done Bible movies, I think just indicates that it might not be absolutely prevalent, but I think that dissidence does exist in certain segments.
Yeah, I hear you. I get your point. I think it's that Christians are stupid and they just recognize the name and check that box.
God, that's better than them dealing with the nuances. Yeah. He's like, hey, don't call me.
Dude, they haven't watched that stuff. Dumb. They just heard about him and said, oh, he sounds creative, favorable.
Oh my God.
Now that is a hot take.
I'm just soaking it in.
Right.
Just absorbing this.
All right. What do you got, Emily?
Okay. Yeah. So, sort of switching gears. So we have talked a lot before just about like the number of Christians has declined in America. And it's right now, it doesn't really seem like that's changing. But a new study did come out specifically looking at the numbers post pandemic, because that definitely changed a lot of things. And this new survey found that before the pandemic, adults age 18 to 30, about 70% were attending services. But since the pandemic, recent numbers show that it's only about 57% are still attending. So that's a 13% decline in just like 2 or 3
years. Is that all Christians, or is that our age demographic?
Like, sorry, yeah, that is the 18 to 30 range.
18 to 30 range.
Yeah, it's so, dropped 13% just with young adults.
And it's like 57% of all young adults, or all young adults who say they're Christian?
Adults who say they are Christian.
So I'm a Christian 25-year-old and only half of them go to church. That's crazy.
Is it?
That's crazy.
It takes 30 days to develop a habit.
I thought it was 21.
Okay, 21 days to develop a habit, right? So we had to sit at home for a year and a half and watch, you know, church on television, et cetera, et cetera. And we got comfortable. So you'd have to almost fight to break the habit of the comfortability at home. So to me, it's not that far-fetched,
dude.
Especially if your relationships in your congregation were pretty shallow.
Yeah, I went to a game last night with a buddy, and we were talking after the game, and I was asking him about this church that, you know, he used to be a leader at. He was in the worship team. And I was like, how's it going over there? And he's like, oh, actually, you know, we haven't been since COVID. And he said, honestly, now I don't think I could get my wife to go to a church on Sunday. Like, we've just gotten so used to it after COVID that, like, it would be too disruptive to our family and stuff. Mm-hmm. And like, they were like leaders at the church, and they haven't been back since COVID. So I think you're right.
Yeah. But I think the other thing too, is this just, and I'm not a church historian, so this is me kind of talking off the cuff here, but like, is this just an accelerant to the next chapter of how people experience church? Because the modern way that we all grew up experiencing it, which was in, you know, kind of established evangelical-ish, you know, a lot of non-denominational, non-traditional ways of gathering on Sunday mornings with big screens and lights and loud bands, that's a very, very contemporary construct, right? Mm-hmm. Like before that, it was pews and hymns and churches where, you know, it was a central part of like a little community.
A neighborhood. Yeah.
Yeah. It was your neighborhood. Then you go back further, and then you could look at like the Catholic Church in Europe, where it was actually like kind of a civil institution, where it was like almost like part of the government, you know, like church, the crosses on the flag. Then you go back further, and it was like just people meeting in houses. Like, is it just not that Big C church is in decline? It's just that the way we think about it, some social event happened, whether it was, you know, in the past political upheaval or new laws passed or the expansion of, you know, empires and things that caused the way that people experience church to change. Did the pandemic, was it just the latest kind of thing that shifts the way that people think about what church is, you know?
Yeah, I think you're right. But like, the thing that gives me pause in this is go back 5 years and think about the congregation experience that we all had, right? It was a lot of times it was surface level, and a lot of my friends, if this was the only Jesus they were getting all week, you know what I mean? They weren't in the word. They weren't in small group. They weren't studying scripture, reading Christian books. They checked the box. They checked the faith box by going to church on Sunday. So now they're not even doing that. So it's like, I don't think it's just like the church will evolve and find new ways to grow. These people are just going to drift away from faith. You know what I mean? So
yeah,
it's,
I think we have a perfect storm here. You have one, you have the pandemic, which it just changed the way, not only did it change the way for the church, but it just changed the way we consume knowledge and information in general. Like, our attention spans are shorter and we're quick to the point. We want to be on there. I think too, you also have to, we have to address the concept of the church hurt.
Mm-hmm.
Like, not necessarily people at their local church, but the way that politics became front and center in the church, people with differing views start looking at their pastors and be like, well, why would he believe that? Or even pastors making stances on certain things, right, that may not have thought about the implications of it. I don't even think it was just like, oh, I just want to stand with this or that. It's like they may not have thought about how others would receive that. Mm-hmm. They just thought they were standing for truth, and it created a level of tension there, right? Mm-hmm. And then I would say, Cameron, the third part, which is pre-church, or pre the pandemic, a lot of us were going to church because of social pressure, mm-hmm. more than feeling enriched and in some sort of community. It was, hey, I don't want to be the guy that didn't show up for a month and a half. And, you know, that happened. So now pandemic comes, blows all of that up. And now it's a, well, do I really even need this experience anymore? And people are starved for actual community. So I think the churches, Cameron, I feel what you're saying, but I also think the churches that can actually create community where people feel involved, because it's hard to feel in community at a big church, right? I think the ones that actually create that community, people will want to come back to something like that. I just don't know if we're going to go back to what we came from, where it's the big concert, right? Yeah. And then it's the thing that keeps us there for 2 hours. It's like, nah, man, give me my 45 minutes and let me get some real emotional connection with people.
Or just, you know, a place like the church becoming more of a recentering of social life. Like there's a Presbyterian church in my neighborhood that some of my neighbors, like, you know, they have events all the time. That's just, you know, the purpose of the event isn't like some church initiatives. It just get people in the neighborhood together for a meal or to, you know, do like, you know, decorate a Christmas tree all together, or go do a food drive, or just finding ways to gather people and give them like some sort of social event that they can attend. And hopefully that reinforces like the community aspect, that where spirituality can blossom. Like instead of like reverse engineering, like we're going to start with the spiritual and then we'll build in the social and friendships and relationships. Like maybe it should be starting with relationships and friendships, and then we'll build the spiritual instead of trying to reverse engineer the end product, which I feel like it's easy to fall in the trap to. You know, does that make sense?
It does. Okay. What do you have, Derek?
So I know a couple of years ago, they were trying to ban TikTok in America.
Well, Trump, because of the
Trump
security concerns of the
security
China
issues. Well, that's gaining a lot more steam. Federal employees are banned from having it on their phones. Mm-hmm. And then now a lot of colleges are starting to ban it on their Wi-Fi. Mm-hmm. So University of Texas, Texas A&M,
Oklahoma,
Auburn. So I think it's over 30 colleges are doing that. Mm-hmm. And it's creating a new conversation in the land of the free about the difference between censorship and protection. Some people, if you talk to some people, that's like, no, this is a real security threat. We need to ban this in a country. And others are saying you're banning free speech, and it's creating and there's a bipartisan bill that is on the floor right now about banning that in our country. So some people are saying we're starting to look like China because Facebook's banned in China right now.
Yeah, but the legislation and that's in front of Congress right now is citing that TikTok's Chinese ownership. And the fact that it's come out recently that they are tracking the location of journalists and other politicians, and that they're saying that China is nefariously using TikTok being in our society as a way to exploit our national security. And so they're banning it. They're talking about banning it across the U.S. for security concerns, not free speech concerns.
Right. But people are saying that's a load of crap. There's a debate now here that there's the people that are saying this is kind of like more intrusive for our country than it should be. Like I should be able to be on whatever platform that I want to be on, and you're not allowing that. And as an entertainer, TikTok is the most consumed form of entertainment right now.
Right.
It's at least top. I think it's either right below, YouTube is right below it, but really, it's the biggest consumed media right now. And a lot of people are making a lot of money off of that. So if they ban TikTok, it's going to really
shake up a lot
of stuff. And
it just goes to show these people who have become like super successful on one of these platforms and built an empire,
that's sinking sand, man, because that can get it's ripped dangerous. Out from under you overnight. But the thing that's interesting, back when Trump was railing against it about security concerns, what was being talked about and what was actually in motion was not that the app would have to go away, but the Chinese ownership of the app in the US would have to end. And so basically, at that time, they moved all the data centers that has US data on it to the US. But then that actually has happened. That's current now. And they were going to create a separate division, TikTok US, and that they were going to break that off and break it up the way that they, like, back in the day, they broke up AT&T and they've, you know, broken up monopolies. They were going to break up TikTok and force that the US TikTok be owned by a US company. Microsoft was in motion to buy it. And then the election happened and it stopped. Because it wasn't a priority for the incoming administration, right? That's my guess of what'll happen. It won't be shut down and deleted off your phones, but they're going to force the U.S. TikTok to be broken off of the Chinese ownership. That's my guess.
Yeah, I would agree with that. Yeah. And I also have a twofer. I got another one. Trump back on Facebook. So just letting y'all know.
Yep.
He back on Facebook. He been gone for 2 years, but he back.
I poked him this morning.
I just want to read this because this is hilarious. Like, I forgot how funny, because I don't have True Social, so I forgot how funny that Donald Trump. So this is what Donald Trump says in response to being able to come back. He says, Facebook, you can hear it in his voice. I wish I was Trevor Noah, but Facebook, which has lost billions of dollars in value since deplatforming your favorite president, me, has just announced that they are reinstating my account. Such a thing should never happen again to a sitting president or anybody else who is not deserving of retribution. I swear this sounds like the Joker, but it's hilarious to me.
Guys, I'm frazzled by this TikTok news. I just bought a Spark gas stove with a little app and I downloaded TikTok on it. Now what am I supposed to do? What am I supposed to do with my smart gas stove?
Your smart gas stove.
Hey, listen. TikTok's in, if you have a Tesla, TikTok's in your Tesla. So,
yep.
I mean, if there's a security concern, I'm okay with whatever we need to do to fix it. Because I want to be driving.
The Chinese are watching where you're driving, dude. That's exactly what's going on.
I don't want to be an auto steer and then all of a sudden I go off the meeting.
Yeah, you don't want to say something negative about China and your brakes lock up because you've got TikTok in your Tesla.
All right, that'll do it for Slices. Stay tuned. Up next, Shane Claiborne joins us. You're listening to Baird. The song is Backboard. Where our guest today is Shane Claiborne. He's an activist and author who's about to drop his newest book, Rethinking Life, Embracing the Sacredness of Every Person. He sat down with Emily to discuss what it looks like to advocate for every human life and how we can find hope in a difficult world. Here's our conversation with Shane Claiborne.
Where did the inspiration for this message come from?
Yeah, well, I share a little bit of my own story in the book. I tend to write fairly personally, you know, and I grew up in Tennessee and fell in love with Jesus in the Bible Belt. But I also began to see how my worldview and my political imagination was being shaped in a real particular way. And I think especially when it comes to the idea of what it means to be pro-life, I love that language and fully embraced it. But then I began to see the limitations that we put on that, you know, so kind of how narrowly we had defined pro-life to one issue on abortion and on a host of other things. We Christians were not only silent, but we were an obstacle to, I think, things that would actually save lives, and you know, particularly on the death penalty, the biggest supporters, the base for the death penalty has been Christians. And when it comes to gun violence. Christians are the highest gun owning demographic in America.
Of course.
So, I mean, all these things were troubling, but you know, I really wanted to not abandon the language and the idea of being for life, but to expand it, you know, to really invite people to think more broadly. And that's what's happened for me is I'm not less pro-life. I'm more pro-life than I, you know, I was when I was 15 years old. So, yeah.
What can we as the church and as Christians do to make sure we're not politicizing this issue? Because, like you said, we should be pro-life, not because of politics, but because of our faith.
Yeah, the question that kind of reverberates all through Rethinking Life is, what does love require of us? And I think that's exactly the right question. You know, Jesus said that they will know that you're my disciples by your love. All, you know, scripture says over and over, all the law is summed up into this: love God, love your neighbor. And so, you know, the question of what does love look like? Well, you know, we know what love doesn't look like, and we've seen a lot of that, especially in what many would call the pro-life movement. And I'm sure some of them would say that they're acting in love towards unborn children. But I really, this is where in the book I point to Mother Teresa as a model. Obviously, Jesus is the ultimate model of what love looks like. But Mother Teresa is really helpful when it comes to being an advocate for life and including abortion. And I talk about, you know, the time I spent in India working with her. Everyone called her mother. And we kind of think of Mother Teresa, it becomes this kind of phrase that it's become so familiar, we lose the depth of it. And I met this like 20-year-old guy that said, you know why we call her mother? Because she rescued us, you know, from, some of us were abandoned in train stations. Some of us had, you know, moms that weren't able to raise us. And so, I mean, that was Mother Teresa. She just started taking folks in. And this young guy was telling me she's kind of like that old, you know, the woman in the shoe that doesn't, you know, so many kids, she doesn't know what to do. You know, she just started loving people in tough situations. And she was very passionate about abortion. She spoke about it. Bill Clinton invited her to the National Prayer Breakfast, and she talked about her passion on abortion. But, you know, isn't that interesting that Bill Clinton invited Mother Teresa to speak? Because there was a better conversation, I think, happening. But Mother Teresa wasn't a single issue person either. She called governors the night before executions, you know, and would tell them to show mercy, to do what Jesus would have them do. She didn't just have bumper stickers and t-shirts. She didn't hold signs that say abortion is murder. She came alongside people, and she had compassion along with her conviction on these issues. So I think that's really what the sort of posture we need, you know, and not just on abortion, but every issue, you know, and to think about the people who are impacted. And that's why part of this book gets really personal, because both my wife and my mom have been impacted by this and, you know, gave me permission. In fact, Katie wrote a section of the book. And so, you know, 1 in 4 women has had an abortion. That's what our statistics are. And so we need to talk about this in a way that respects the complexity and the pain and the impact that this has had on people that might be really, really close to us and certainly are in our pews and workplaces, but probably even in our own family. So let's treat this issue with the love it respects, because it's not just an issue. You know, we're talking about people's lives.
What do you want the readers to take away from this book?
The invitation of this book is to step back just a little bit from all the culture wars and rhetoric and the polarizing debates in our, you know, the division in our country, and to look at life and say, this is good. I mean, that's how the whole story begins. God creates everything and calls it good. And to say that every person is precious, That's my real hope, you know, and I kind of begin the book by saying it. The first time that we see the word sin in the Bible is actually not in the Garden of Eden when we think about the original sin and the fall and the, you know, eating of the forbidden fruit, but it's the sin, the word sin first appears when Cain kills his brother Abel and it breaks God's heart. And every time we kill one another, I think it breaks God's heart. Anytime we crush a life that God has made in God's own image, God feels that personally. And that's, I think, my hope is that we would lean in to the pain of the world and let it move us and let it create not just a grief, but a passion to protect life, to stand up for people who are being crushed, to amplify the voices that people are not listening to, and say these lives matter to God. Black lives matter to God. Native lives matter to God. Palestinian lives matter to God. Haitian lives matter to God. Trans lives matter to God. Like every single person is a bearer of God's image in the world, a child of God. And so let's treat them like that.
That was Shane Claiborne. Make sure to check out his upcoming book. You can pre-order it now, Rethinking Life. Listening to Maud Latour. The song is Trees. I like that one. Well, I had mentioned that at the beginning of the show, I mentioned that here at the end of the show, we'd have table topics. We do not. Slices ran a little long, and that's a good thing, right? It was a good conversation. Slices ran a little long, and we ran out of time to do it this week. So we will be skipping this segment, and we'll do it. We'll do it next week. Actually, I think if Jamie's back next week, I think we're going to do another round of A Truth and Two Lies, or Two Lies and a Truth, or whatever it's called. That was fun. All right. Anyway, well, before we wrap things up, again, I want to thank Shane Claiborne for joining us. Make sure to pre-order Rethinking Life now. Also, make sure to check out relevantmagazine.com every day. We're covering a lot of stuff there at the intersection of faith, life, culture. You can see our digital magazine there by clicking on the magazine tab. We've got great features in it, conversations with MIA, Sterling K. Brown, Elevation Worship, some other stuff. And if you want the beautifully designed, enhanced edition of the magazine, perfect for tablets and other devices, you can subscribe to Relevant Plus. It's our best way to experience our content. You get ad-free reading there at relevantmagazine.com. You get, like I said, the enhanced digital magazine. You get a exclusive subscriber podcast each week, and you get an ad-free version of this very podcast. Plus, a lot more will be rolling out this year. We're very excited about Relevant Plus. Plans start as low as $250 a month, and you can find out all the information by clicking the Relevant Plus tab right there in the header at relevantmagazine.com. Okay, on that note, we'll wrap it up. I'm Cameron Strang.
I'm Jesse Carey.
I'm Derek Miner.
I'm Emily Brown.
We will see you on Friday. Have a great week, everyone.
Listening to the Relevant Podcast. Check out our features, interviews, and news updates every day at relevantmagazine.com. And make sure to follow Relevant on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram for the latest. For more great podcasts, browse the shows on the Relevant Podcast Network, which you can find at our site. And while you're there, don't miss the all-new era of Relevant Magazine. A new issue releases every other month at relevantmagazine.com.
Quentin Tarantino.
Relevant Podcast Network.